The new iPad Pro looks a lot like last year's model. Same thin, flat design, same solid feel in the hand, but spend some real time with it and you'll notice the changes run deeper, especially if you push your tablet hard. So here's what's actually new and what quietly surprised me after a week of use. Let's get started with the star of the show, the new Apple M5 chip. The biggest leap is in how it handles AI and graphics. If you're pushing the iPad with heavy creative apps, the CPU is faster, especially on the higher end 1 and 2 terabyte models. Those get a full 10-core GPU. You'll see double-digit multi-core gains in apps that push the device, but the headline number is in the graphics. Pro rendering with hardware-accelerated ray tracing is up to 1.5 times faster than last year's M4 model. And the neural engine is where things get wild. Apple claims up to 3.5 times faster AI performance compared to the M4. Now that really just means anything that's gonna be using the neural engine. But now every GPU core has its own neural accelerator. That means things like AI heavy tasks, I'm talking background removal, real-time photo edits, or on-device large language and image generation models, those are all going to be noticeably quicker and can actually run directly on the iPad rather than having to rely on the cloud. So, two examples that I might typically use. This app is called Craft. I love it. It's one of my favorite note-taking and productivity tools. Craft has a built-in AI, and again, it's on the device, not being sent to the cloud. So getting results here is just a lot faster on the M5 model when I ask for information or summaries. Or check this out. If I use Draw Things to create an image, same thing. This is all happening directly on the iPad, not on the cloud. I've got Wi-Fi and cellular turned off here. And as you can see, I can generate a usable image in seconds. This is just really impressive. And with nearly 30% more memory bandwidth now at 153 gigabytes per second, big projects and multitasking keep feeling fast, even with machine learning models running in the background. But all that raw power only matters if the system can keep up, and that's where memory and storage come in. The 256 and 512 gigabyte models now get 12 gigabytes of unified memory. That is a 50% increase in RAM. And if you get the 1 or 2 terabyte models, you're getting 16 gigabytes. That extra headroom means apps rarely need to reload, even if you're jumping between a huge Procreate canvas, a heavy raw photo batch, and a browser with 20 tabs open, or 200 tabs open if you're me. Let's be honest, more like 500. And Apple also doubled the storage speeds this year compared to the M4. So if you work with big video files, ProRes, or just large Adobe Lightroom catalogs, moving data on and off the iPad is genuinely less painful. Now, there are a few more additions Apple made that add speed to the new iPad Pro, including their new M1 chip. The new M1 brings upgraded wireless to the iPad Pro, supporting Wi-Fi 7 on the device for the first time. So if you have a compatible Wi-Fi 7 router, you'll see higher peak wireless speeds and lower latency, which can make a real difference for big AirDrop transfers, fast iCloud syncing, and just real-time collaboration. It also adds Bluetooth 6 for next-gen audio and smart device support, plus Thread for the first time for improved smart home accessory connectivity. Now, one thing to keep in mind as it pertains to Wi-Fi 7 is limited to 320 megahertz channels, so not every Wi-Fi 7 feature is available, like MLO support, for example. And as always, your real-world speeds are going to depend on your router and network environment. Now, the wireless story is not done just yet. Apple also made upgrades to how wireless connections work on the go as well. If you have a cellular model, they are now packing Apple's C1X chip, which we first saw on the iPhone Air a month ago. This brings up to 50% faster 5G speeds compared to just last year's iPad Pro. So if you're uploading 4K videos or downloading large project files or just streaming video while you're traveling, you are going to feel the difference, especially in crowded areas and like fringe coverage. The new modem is also more power efficient, so you'll get better battery life while staying connected. The iPad Pro is eSIM only, which means you can add and swap plans without dealing with physical SIM cards. And I know some people love that, while others prefer the quickness of just removing a physical SIM card and putting it into a new device without having to worry about dealing with carriers. But that is a limitation or benefit, depending on how you see it. Seriously though, cellular connections are fast and responsive and work great on the iPad Pro. When traveling like I am right now, I'll use the iPad as my mobile hotspot for my Mac, and it just works flawlessly. Being able to use this thing no matter where I am, including at these hotels with frustratingly slow Wi-Fi, is a godsend. So much so that I'm keeping my fingers crossed that we'll see Apple finally integrate the C1X or the C2X or whatever C modem that they want into a future MacBook Pro. One new feature that I have not gotten to test personally, just because I haven't been home for the whole week that I've been testing the new iPad Pro, is 120 hertz external display support. That includes adaptive sync for lower latency and less stutter. That's great for things like drawing and Procreate while previewing your canvas on a bigger screen, or even just smoother gaming on a larger display. Oh, and speaking of displays, the iPad displays are unchanged. There's still that fantastic tandem OLED that we got last year. So the glossy display hits you with those inky blacks and rich color, while the nano-texture looks different by design. The glass is etched at the nanometer level to scatter ambient light while keeping contrast, so glare drops without turning the screen into a gray haze. If you work under studio lights or outdoors or just anywhere bright, the nano-texture version is the one that's going to save your eyes. But if you edit HDR videos and controlled lighting and want the most sparkle, then you're going to want to just go glossy. But I must say, I am a nano-texture convert when it comes to the iPad. Battery life doesn't seem to have changed. It's still all day in real-world use, and Apple has historically targeted 10 hours of battery life for iPads just for a long time now. But this is the first iPad Pro to support fast charging. So when using a 60-watt adapter or something like Apple's new 40-watt dynamic charger, I regularly went from a completely dead iPad to about 50% battery in under half an hour. That is super convenient for the iPad in particular, because the battery life, even at half full, is going to last you almost an entire day. Now, if you're choosing between sizes, the 11-inch is going to be the sweet spot for portability. This is the iPad to get if you want to hold it in your hand most of the time, almost like a digital clipboard. 13-inch is still usable handheld, but in my opinion, this one is better in a keyboard case just due to the size. You get a laptop class canvas for work, gaming, and watching content. Also, remember what I said earlier. You get 12 gigs of RAM on the 256 and 512 gigabyte models and 16 gigs on the 1 and 2 terabyte versions. If you're asking, is this the iPad that's gonna replace my laptop? The answer remains the same. It depends on your apps and your workflow. But compared to last gen, the M5 iPad Pro moves the needle in ways you will feel immediately. Faster AI processing, more RAM where you need it, twice as fast storage, faster wireless if you have a Wi-Fi 7 network, faster cellular when on the go, 120 hertz external display support, and finally, fast charging. The result is a tablet that just gives you back your time, which I can definitely appreciate. If you've been waiting for an iPad Pro that feels meaningfully smarter, this is it. Of course, the other side of the story is iPadOS 26, which brings several big new features to the iPad, like multiple windows, the new liquid glass design, and deep Apple Intelligence features for translation, automation, and on-device AI. I've got a whole video giving you the full rundown, which you can check out here or at the link down in the description below. Thanks for watching, as always, guys. I appreciate your support. I'm Andrew Edwards, and I will catch you in the next video.